paper, it might be in color or it might be white, it's falling out on the floor. So pick it up. And what we would like you to do is it's time to update our 2017 director. But if you will remember a couple of weeks ago, for those of you who were here and for those of you that might have missed that Sunday, Pastor talked in his sermon about ways of communicating. And that if you have a phone that gets text messages and it beeps at you, you normally will look at that versus if someone calls you or sends you an email. So we're going to start texting those of you that have cell phones that receive text messages if you will let us. Some of you, we have your cell phone numbers. Some of you, we do not. So on this paper, we left room for that cell phone number. If you're in a household that has, you have one and your husband or wife also has a cell phone, please list both and we will send the message to both phones. Because I know there are occasions when husbands and wives just do not communicate quite the way they should. So we will send it to both. If, however, you have a cell phone that you have to pay for that text and you do not want to receive text messages, please note that as well, and we won't text you so you don't have to pay for that, but you will have to go look at your emails and then we'll try to email that message to you. If you've moved or any new information that you have to tell us, to let us know so that we can communicate to you what's happening and what's going on, please include it in this and then put this in the offering plate. Now, that means you shouldn't be doing this during the sermon, but right now, and not listening to what I'm saying. So fill this out, but not during the sermon. Okay. Oh, there he is. Okay, he heard you say that. Okay, and now I've just been given another announcement. It is that time of the year again when we have to think about the 2017 altar flower calendar. Please sign up on the pink sheets in the back of the church and place your name beside the date you want, also designating the recognition of those flowers and who that's for, please. So the pink sheets in the back, sign up for flowers. The other paper could be green, orange, white, they're all different colors. Makes no difference, doesn't mean anything, we're just using up old paper. Okay, alrighty, thanks.
As you probably noticed, Adoptive Family is all set up and ready to go in the back of the church. This year we have two families for a total of six children. If you wish to partake, choose an ornament and sign your name on the respective sheet. So I kind of know when the time is up, if something isn't back, I know who to call. The wish list items, of which the children get two, are not absolute or written in stone. They're just suggestions, so you can use your own judgment. In addition, each family will get a box of non-perishable food items. So if you would care to help with that, we put some suggestions back there. Most of the children are on either free or reduced lunch program, so when they're home over the holidays, it becomes a little bit of a hardship to provide for them. So anyway, we ask that you have these items back by Sunday, December 11th. And in the past, we have had such a success because this church has big, generous hearts. Thanks.
Thank you. join in praying the prayer of July the first Advent candle this morning. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe. You call all nations to walk in your light and to seek your ways of justice and peace. For the night is past, the dawn of your coming is near. Bless us as we light the first candle of this retreat. Rouse us in sleep, that we may be ready to dream our Lord, in conscience to walk up him into our hearts and homes. For he is our light and our salvation. Blessed be God forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake, forgive us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our opening hymn.
Thank you.
of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace let us pray to the Lord. Thank you.
Reading from Isaiah. The word that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In the days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many peoples shall come and say, "Come, let us go into the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths." For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read Psalm 122 responsibly. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Now our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you.
Peace be within your walls, and quietness within your towers. For the sake of my kindred and companions, I pray for your prosperity. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek to do you good.
Reading from Romans. Besides this, you know what time it is. How it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Yes, Jesus.
Doesn't sound like you must have been up late last night, but the football game was over early, so.
Yes, I was.
I know, well. Marvin, today is the first Sunday of Advent. Does anyone know what Advent means?
I do.
Okay, what does it mean, Marvin?
Advent is the first season of the church year, and it leads up to Christmas.
Well, that's right, Marvin. Kids, do you understand what the name of the, or do you remember what the name of the first candle was we lit? I think you talked about it in Sunday school. What was the name of the first candle? Do you remember? Hope. Absolutely, it was hope. And it was for those of you who weren't in Sunday school on the front of your bulletin. And Marvin, during Advent, what would you like to talk about?
Well, I think we need to talk about the Nativity.
Okay, Marvin, what is the Nativity?
Well, take a look on the table. I have built the village of Bethlehem and the beginning of the Nativity scene. The Nativity scene represents where Jesus was born.
Well, thank you, Marvin. Let's take a look here at Bethlehem. We see a couple of homes here, and we see some off in the distance. But what is this building called? Does anyone know? Logan? Well, it's like a barn. It has a specific, what do you call it? I'm sorry, what? A cabin? Well, no, it's not ever been called a cabin. How about a stable? A stable, yeah. And it's like a barn because that's where the owners of the homes kept their animals. And do you remember in the Christmas story, Jesus was born in a stable because there wasn't any room for him in the local hotel or inn. But before we get there, I would like to take a look at the stable, and it's kind of empty right at the moment. But does anyone know who this might be? Mary, absolutely. Stella, would you like to put Mary in the stable? Set her right in there. Yeah, that's wonderful. Now, Mary was the mother of Jesus. And she was a young woman that had God in her heart, and she loved him very much. She prayed often to God, and all of you are praying often to God, right? When you prayed this morning, I know, in Sunday school, and you used the five-finger prayer. Did you do that? All right, good. And she walked with God in all things that she did, and God chose her to be Jesus's earthly mother. And the rest of the month, we're going to fill up our stable with other characters. We have to wait now till next week to see who the next two are that are coming. Okay? So, can you pray with me? Dear Father in heaven, we love you and want to have you in our hearts just like Mary. Amen. We'll see you next week.
Anyway, in Kentucky, they built the Amish built a replica, the full-size replica.
the insides and animatronics and all that jazz. So you get down and see how big that dude really was. But we didn't have that, except we had the cubits and the measurements that God gave Noah to build his ship. And we share the amusement that Noah's neighbors must have felt. You can imagine somebody undertaking such a project in the arid region, you know, a ship of that magnitude, a wooden ship, and it must have taken he and his sons a long time to build. And no doubt, they made jokes about it. They had references to it. They thought he was probably kind of crazy. And I'm sure that Noah had, along the way, some doubts concerning the whole affair. The very absurdity of all, of course, was meant for God to be a sign. A sign, you know, points us to something beyond the sign. A sign points us to something else. And what this sign was supposed to point the people to was that they should wake up, take notice, assess the situation, and turn back to God. Repent. Come home to God. There was time for them to repent, to turn around toward God and seek God. There was all the time to come to know his sons to build the ark. What were the people doing while Noah was building? Well, they were doing things like eating and drinking, celebrating, marrying, having children, and working. About the same sort of things we do today. And Jesus said about them, they were totally unconcerned until the flood came and destroyed them. From the ancient example of those who perish, Jesus turns toward the future and says, so will it be the coming of the Son of Man, which is like saying, it will be about the way it always has been. Not one thing about human nature has really changed in all of human history. But now instead of a flood, two men will be out in the field. One will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together. One will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, Jesus says, for you do not know on what day the Lord is coming. I saw a bumper sticker one time on a car that said, in case of rapture, this car will be empty. Now, many today view this scripture text as speaking about what is known as a quote-unquote rapture. That is, the belief that when before Jesus comes, before his second coming back to earth, all those who belong to the Lord, those people the Lord will take up to meet him in the air, like Elijah was taken up into heaven by the whirlwind. We think it was a chariot of fire. He saw the chariots of fire, but it was really, if you read the text closely, he was taken up in a whirlwind to heaven. So we think it's going to be like that, that kind of escape, the terminal velocity out of this joint and with the Lord. And those who are with the Lord will continue, those who are not with the Lord will continue here on earth through what John in the book of Revelation said is to be the great tribulation. Well, now, from my study, I believe this scenario which the Lord referred to has nothing to do with a rapture. Dr. Ken Bailey, a scholar on Middle Eastern culture, gives us insight into another possible explanation of Jesus' warning. He says, in Bedouin society, the raiding party was held to be a divine obligation. And it was for Midianites as well. This raiding party is, these people were on the fringe of society. And they had camels, and they knew how to ride camels. Not only lead them, they knew how to ride them. And what they would do is they would wait until the harvest was in. And then they would sweep in out of the desert like a blitzkrieg, very fast arrival, on these animals. And when nobody was expecting them to come, like Alibaba and the 40 thieves, they'd go in and raid the granaries because they weren't farmers. They had camels. And so they'd take, steal the grain. Sometimes there was fighting. Sometimes people would die. And sometimes the Midianites would actually take people. They would steal people and either make them slaves to their own community or sell them into slavery to make some extra money on the side. This, I think, is what Jesus was referencing. This was, that makes sense. You have two people in the field. They're harvesting or they're working in the field. And this marauder comes out of nowhere, and they take, you know, they kill or take one person, two women are in there grinding meal, one is taken, one is left. understood, these people would have understood that kind of concept. And I think that's what Jesus was using, the image of a marauding raiding party as the image of the swiftness and unpredictability of his return to earth, his second coming. If this is true, then those who are taken are not blessed of the Lord, as we sometimes suppose. But in reality, it is those who are left behind who belong to the Lord and who are blessed of God. Hence, then, Jesus' next sentence makes perfect sense. If not, you're thinking, it doesn't make sense at all. If the ones who are blessed are the ones taken, then what Jesus says next doesn't make sense. But if the ones who are blessed are the ones who stayed, weren't taken, then this makes sense. Because Jesus said to them, if the owner of the house had known at what part of the night the thief was coming, he would stay awake and he would not have let his house be broken into. Hey, if you know when the Midianites were coming and they were going to sweep through and they were going to raid your crops, wouldn't you stay awake? Wouldn't you prepare? Wouldn't you get the women and children out of the way so they couldn't be stolen? Wouldn't you be armed and ready for these marauders coming? Absolutely you would be ready. So nobody would be taken. So nobody would fall in harm's way. So none of your crops would capture through the winter would be taken and stolen from you. Right? Absolutely. Makes perfect sense. Because Jesus said, you be prepared, he exhorted you. For the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. As I reflected on these two images, what surfaced for me is significant is first concerning the truth about our human nature. You know, our human nature has not changed in thousands of years. I know some of you like to do woodworking, and you love woodworking. You love wood. And what do you love about wood? How you can shape it, mold it. But don't you also love when you get a great piece of wood, you look at the grain in the wood, and you think, oh my gosh, this is a fabulous. When this is sanded and oil finished or however it is, that grain is going to pop out. It'll be fabulous, beautiful, right? And you know that grain was set in that piece of wood as it was growing. And once the grain is set, it doesn't change. The grain in the wood is always going to be the grain in the wood. It's the same way with our human nature. The grain, our human nature, is set in human flesh. It doesn't change. It's been that way since the fall. It's been that way from Genesis chapter 3. And what we find out, despite Jesus' exhortation to be prepared, humanity's prognosis is terminal unpreparedness. It is inevitable that Jesus' return will utterly surprise the culture in which we live. Now, it may not surprise you if you're paying attention, if you know the word, if you're keeping things in perspective, you know Jesus can come at any time. And so you're going to prepare for him, and you're going to live as if he could come at any time. The culture in which we live, they're not looking for Jesus. They don't even believe in Jesus, most of them. And certainly, they don't believe he's ever coming. They don't think he came first time. They don't think he's coming a second time. They're going to utterly be lost when he comes. And here's the thing. You know from your Jewish history that Jesus uses this image with them, part of it, the suddenness. And he says, you know, the angels of heaven aren't going to know. The Son isn't going to know. Only God knows. Only the Father knows. Right now of the liturgy for people who get engaged in the Jewish life. Right? That's where those words come from. That echo back to that is something Jesus echoed back to for the people to say exactly. Dan is the one who says everything's ready. The wedding's going to be tonight. The son didn't know. The mom didn't know. The bridegroom didn't know. Only Dad knew. When the little house was ready, when everything was ready, you know, Dad said tonight, today, we go get your bride. And so the family was sent to the village and say, come on over. The wedding's going to be. And they had a whole week of festivity. And they went and got the bride. And he surprised her and brought her back. And the wedding happened. And it was marvelous. That echo back, they would have understood that absolutely. Of course only Dad knows. Of course God in heaven is the only one who knows when this is going to happen. So he echoes back to something they knew very well. To again undergird the idea that his coming will be sudden and unexpected. And he asked me, well, how come people won't get it? Well, people don't get stuff today about
even economics, even about the world we live in. I mean, how many $1 trillion are we in debt now? Anybody know? Isn't it 19 plus dollars? 19 trillion? I don't know what trillion is. It's a lot of dough. It's a lot of money. Well, whatever it is, 19 is bigger than 50. I know that much. It's a huge amount of money. I also know that most of us don't worry about it too much, right? We just go on. But we also know that the Fed up until recently, every month, was digitizing. They weren't even printing it anymore. They just said it. They just wrote a number on the books. $80 billion a month, year after year after year. Now, they don't do it anymore, but they're still, you know, doing stuff on us, because when those notes come due, you know, like we should pay them back, we borrow them from ourselves, guess what? They just roll it over. Well, you know what happens? You just renew the debt. The debt hasn't gone down, it just gets climbing bigger. You know, I looked at the chart. In 2000, we actually had a tax surplus. We were in the black in the year 2000. Every year since that, we've had to borrow copious amounts of money to balance our budget as a nation. And yet, doesn't life just bumble along? You know, I mean, aren't babies still born? Aren't people still having kids? Aren't we still marrying people? Aren't people still going to work? Aren't people still saving up to go on vacation, dreaming about what they're going to do, you know, on their anniversary, on and on and on? Absolutely, don't we? Absolutely. We live as if tomorrow will take care of itself. Even though we know better, at some point in time, our economy can take a huge dip, it can take a hard hit. We could really go down. People could lose everything they own. You know, in the stock market, your 401k, we know that, you know, up here. But we live as if it's never going to happen. Now, if we live that way, don't you think people have always lived that way? Back in Noah's day, in Jesus' day, in our day? We can understand that. We get it. But you know better, because you know Jesus is going to come. Now, here's my deal. I think I'm going to be there. I'm not saying that because, you know, I know something, you know, extra that you don't know. Here's what I know. Jesus is going to come someday. And I'm either going to be dead or I'm going to be alive, right? I got those two options as far as I know. Sometimes Debbie says, you may die today if you don't, you know, straighten out. Well, she may not say that, but she thinks a lot. I see it on her face, right? Anyway, and if you're married, you've had that look. Well, here's the thing. If Jesus comes, I'll see him. If I'm dead, I'm going to see it. I'll be there. I'll just see it from the reverse angle. I'm coming with him. That's the two options. Now, we're supposed to live as if he'd come today and live that way and be good stewards of our life, our talents, our abilities, and live with vigor and gusto and grace and goodness. Why do we have a lighter thing to do? Because there'll come a day when this is over, and you don't have any time. So let's not live with, you know, with any regrets. Let's go for growth. Live as if this could be our last day, our last week, our last year. And live it with grace and goodness and love. And that way, when you look back, there are no regrets. You know, I've never gone now. Nick, if I'm wrong, you tell me. But I know you've probably done more funerals than I have. Has anybody at a funeral said, I've got one regret? Just one. I spent way more too much time with that person. If I had to do it over again, I'd never spend that much time with him or her. No one ever says that. They always say to me, if the time of death, he said, I knew they were going to come. I just didn't think it'd be today. I thought we had today to be together. I'd like one more day, one more month, one more year. I wish I had more time with my child, my husband, my wife, my brother, my sister. If you love them, you never have enough time with them. And if you live well and you love well, you can say, well, I wish I had more, but I'm grateful for every moment I had. We lived it to the full. We had a great time together. What a life we had together. It was a grace. It was a mercy. It was a gift of God. And I'll always be thankful for that. Let's live that way. Let's live that way. Second, very quickly, there's also some very good news in this text that accompanies Jesus' warning. For the one coming, the one who will sweep onto the stage of human history for the second time, will be the one who knows my name. Think of that. The one who sweeps on the canvas of human history is someone who will know your name. No, not only know your name, but know everything about you. They love you completely. Know how many hairs the number of your head, no matter where you are in life's journey, whether you got a lot or little, they'll know everyone you got. And he loves you. He will know your name. And your name is written in his book of life. It is the sign of his cross that I bear, that you bear upon my breast and on my brow. In holy baptism, God made me, did make you his very own, adopted you as God's own child, sealed you with the Holy Spirit, and gifted you with the indwelling of his Holy Spirit. It is in his name that you now transact the business of life and of living. And it is by the power of the Holy Spirit that trust and faith are created and engendered within your life. It's not out of fear, then, that I wait on my Lord's return, or you wait on your Lord's return. But it is with bread-hungry expectation and hope that I long to see my Lord face to face.
Father, for the church, the world, for all people according to their needs.
stir up your power, O Lord, and purify your church. Make it a holy dwelling fit for your Son. Make it your house into which the nations stream with gladness and joy. Make it in the new Jerusalem the home of all whom you have made children of the day. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Stir up your power, O Lord, and make yourself known to all who ignore or despise you. Humble their pride, illuminate their minds, and soften their hearts. Help all who bear Christ's name to shine his light on their path, so together we may stand in your presence to praise your name. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Stir up your power, O Lord, and banish the evils of violence, chaos, brutality, and hatred from the death-shattered world. Until that day dawns, give wisdom and understanding, counsel and might to all who take up arms in defense of life and liberty, to all who protect our communities from danger, and to the first responders. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Stir up your power, O Lord, and bring healing and hope to all those whose need is great. We live before your throne of grace, our home mount, our church family and friends in need of healing, strength, and comfort. Those named in our bulletin on our prayer chain, and those whom we name aloud or in the quiet of our own hearts. Deliver them from everything that darkens their lives and restore them to full fellowship with all who love them. Give patience, gentleness, and rest to two caregivers, and shine the light of your love upon us all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Stir up your power, O Lord. Use our words and deeds so that many may take heart and trust in you, and steadfast watch for the coming of Christ until he returns in glory to lead all the redeemed into your welcome embrace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I'd like to share Christ's own peace one with another.
I know.
was betrayed, he remembered how he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to all of them to drink, saying, "This cup was to be covenanted in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together we pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Thank you.
name of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord will upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.